We begin with the mythology that surrounds Cancer the Crab. Out of all the zodiacal constellations that exist, Cancer really is one of the most inconspicuous. Its stars are pretty faint, and unless you live in an area where there's very little light pollution, Cancer can definitely be a challenge to find. For me, I was able to figure out where this constellation was by finding Gemini, which has two really bright stars and an easy pattern. And I was able to find Leo, which also has a very distinctive pattern. And using a star chart, I realized that Cancer sat right in the middle of these two. And I was also able to figure out it was Cancer based upon this star cluster that sits right in the middle of the constellation. And it's really beautiful to look at if you're able to magnify it through binoculars or a telescope. And when I first found this cluster, I wanted to know more about it, and I was really pleased to find a rich history that surrounds a celestial object. We'll talk about that a little bit later in the video, but just remember, a theme throughout this video will be that if you can find Gemini and if you can find Leo, you should be able to figure out where Cancer is because it's right in between them. And the key is also making sure you're away from light pollution and you have a very, very dark sky. In terms of how Cancer got its name, there is some debate out there as to how the name originated. Some believe that in this region of the sky, it was named for the crab because at one time the sun was moving through Cancer. And then it stopped moving northward and then started to move south. And this backward motion of the sun was much like a crab being able to walk backwards. And this could have been one of the reasons this area of the sky was named after a crab. But the most famous legend that comes to mind when talking about Cancer is the legend of Hercules, or Heracles in the Roman version. And a crab was sent by Hera, the ever-jealous god, who is always challenging Hercules. She sent a crab to distract him while he was fighting the many-headed monster known as Hydra. And Cancer only really nicked Hercules' heel, and then he was crushed. So Hera placed the crab up in the sky to honor his bravery. And over time, there have been different stories, but this is, out of all the research I've done, this is the main one that keeps popping up everywhere. And in other legends, Cancer has been depicted in many different ways. For example, some cultures like the Greeks saw a crab. The Egyptians identified Cancer as a scarab beetle. The Babylonians saw the crab and also a snapping turtle in other regions of Babylonia. There's another Latin translation that depicts Cancer as a crayfish. And even in the early 17th century, Cancer was identified as a lobster, as to what you can see here. What is interesting is that even though the creatures varied throughout time and cultures, Cancer has always been depicted as an animal that has a hard exoskeleton and lives in water. So again, that really is an amazing thing that many different cultures saw something different but similar. As a reminder, Cancer is sandwiched in between two very prominent constellations, Leo and Gemini. And Cancer really is that transition from going into the winter constellations and moving into the spring constellations. So you're going to be able to see it, you know, towards the end of winter, depending on where you are on the Earth. That also has something to do with it. But, you know, you can see it in late February if you stay out late into March, April, and May. And as I'm recording this now, it's the month of July, and I can still see Cancer, but I also live in Hawaii, and at about 20 degrees latitude. So that allows me to see more constellations for a longer period of time. And I'd like to say this is an easy constellation to find, but it is a little challenging because the stars in it are so faint. If you live in a place with lots of light pollution, chances are you may not be able to identify this. Its stars are only that, about fourth magnitude, but you really want to be able to look for this star cluster, which I will teach you about coming up. So without further ado, let's get into the pattern of what Cancer looks like. So here is a picture of Cancer. There are some other constellations in here, but only partial constellations. And as you look at this photograph, I want you to start, observing what is it that stands out to you? What draws your eye when you look at this picture? Do you see bright stars? Do you see any clusters of stars? So hopefully, and again, I always encourage you, if you want more time to look at this, it's good. You can always hit pause and try to figure out what you're looking at. But as we move on, this is where Cancer is located. That's its pattern. And if we move back to this picture, I'm hoping that this star cluster is what stood out to you right here. And that cluster is known as the Beehive Cluster. That's one of its many names. It's also Messier Object 44, and we'll go into detail about that in a little bit. But hopefully, you were able to see this star cluster when I originally pointed out the constellation. If you also notice these bright stars, that's excellent. These are the heads of Gemini. We have Pollux and Castor. If you notice this star right here, this is Procyon. This is one of the bright stars of Canis Minor, the small dog. So again, it's good to kind of realize what else we're looking here. And as I will constantly remind you, Cancer is situated between Gemini and Leo. Leo is not part of this picture. But here is the basic shape, and to me, I kind of see an upside down Y. And yes, you will have to use some imagination as to, oh my goodness, what, how did people see this as a crab? Well, you have to be creative and use your imagination. But one thing I will point out to you is that I want you to notice how it's situated. You always notice that there's a claw down here. And Cancer is facing Leo. So if you would come back here, this would be a claw, possibly this could be a claw, maybe this represents the legs. I say that with a question mark because, again, I don't really see a crab here, but not all constellation patterns really match up with what they're supposed to look like. Here's another image of what Cancer the crab looks like. Notice the upside down Y shape. And then I'd like you also to notice Gemini right here, where you can see Pollux and Castor. And then right down here, you have Canis Minor, which has another bright star called Procyon. And of course, notice that Cancer is situated between Gemini and Leo. So, what I want you to look for in the next picture are some of these bright stars, and then you're going to look for M44, the Beehive Cluster, to see if you can find it. So, remember from the last picture, I'm hoping that you find Pollux and Castor, the two bright stars of Gemini, and then Procyon, which is the bright star in Canis Minor. If you can find those three stars, move to the left side of the screen and notice if you can find the Beehive Cluster. Keep in mind that it does take time to get yourself used to the patterns and being able to find them and remembering what they are. So let's take a look at our answer. Here you have Gemini, where you've got Pollux and Castor. And Canis Minor is right down here with the bright star Procyon. If you can find these three, Hopefully, you were able to find the beehive cluster, which is in the constellation of Cancer. Now that I've taught you the pattern of Cancer, let's go through and look at some of the stars. If we take a look at this depiction of Cancer, notice how the stars are not as bright as some of its next-door neighbors. What you want to start to notice is the two bright stars of Gemini, and then the bright star in Canis Minor. And if you can find these three stars, all you have to know is that Cancer sits right next to it. So here is our picture of Cancer. And again, look towards the center of the photo, and you should see the bright star cluster called M44. And from there, try to find the upside down Y shape. You'll also probably notice Castor and Pollux, the bright stars of Gemini, and just a part of the bright star called Procyon in Canis Minor. Here's the shape. And let's look at what the names of some of these stars are. So we have Akubens, which is Arabic for claws. This star is 174 light years away. Next, we have Al-Tarf, again, another Arabic name, which means for the end. This star is 290 light years away. And then we have these two stars sitting right next to each other. We have Ocellus Borealis, which stands for the Northern S. It is 181 light years away. And then Ocellus Australis. This stands for the Southern S or donkey. And this one is 131 light years away. And there's some interesting mythology about both of these stars. According to the Greeks, these stars represented the donkeys that the god Dionysus and his tutor Silenus rode in on the war against the Titans. These donkeys frightened the Titans, and the war against them was won. So the gods placed the donkeys up in the sky to honor them. So that's a little bit of an interesting story there for you about those stars. Finally, we're going to take a look at the celestial objects within Cancer. So looking at our star map here, there's two that we are going to focus on. One is M44 and the other is M67. The location of M44 is right between the two stars that represented the donkey, and it's really a spectacular star cluster. This one is called Messier 44, and it's an open star cluster, which means it's relatively young in the history of the universe, on the order of millions of years. And it's about 515 light years away. And to the unaided eye, it looks like a fuzzy patch in the sky. And it has been called the beehive cluster by early observers because of its resemblance to a swarm of bees. And the name has since stuck in modern times. Some ancient cultures believe they were peering into the floor of heaven called the Gate of Men, where the souls descended from heaven to earth to be born. And it has also been called Precipice. And this star cluster played a very important role in the history of astronomy. Galileo was the first to turn his telescope to this fuzzy patch in the sky, and he discovered it was a star cluster. And this cluster that he discovered, along with many other observations made by Galileo, really became the catalyst to the scientific revolution. The ideas that the universe were laid out, that were laid out by us Aristotle so many years ago, just began to shift once Galileo started to change the old beliefs with his observations of the sky. Our final celestial object within Cancer is called M67, and it again is another open star cluster. It's located towards the bottom of the Y here, and it's not as bright as M44 is, but it still is worth taking a look at through your binoculars or telescope if you have one. So it is about 2700 light years away, and being that it's an open star cluster, it is again relatively young, on the order of millions of years. And we consider that young because the age of the universe is on the order of billions of years. So this star cluster is one that is relatively young. So to review Cancer, the crab, This constellation is best seen in the springtime, and it is a zodiacal constellation, which means that the sun and the planets and the moon all pass through the borders of this constellation. The best way to find it is looking for Gemini, okay? And if you can find the two bright stars of Castor and Pollux, you just need to shift your gaze and try to find the fuzzy patch in the sky. In terms of bright stars, this is not one that has very many bright stars at all. In fact, the way I'm able to identify this in the sky is by looking at the celestial object called the Beehive Cluster, or Praesepe, also known as M44. The other celestial object is located down towards the bottom of the constellation, and that again is another open star cluster. Thank you so much for watching. I hope this was helpful and you were able to learn more about how to identify Cancer in the sky and the objects that are situated within its borders.
Woo!